Greetings and welcome to a very special episode of Road to Paris 2024 with me, Martina Lučić.
And me, Jamie Stangroom. So, on this road that leads to the Paris Olympic Games, we've been talking about the different shooting sport disciplines on the Olympic calendar,
bringing you athlete interviews and much more.
This week, we're taking things in a slightly different direction, a bit of a detour, Martina.
But an important one, as we delve into the importance of psychology in shooting sport.
Yes, we'll be looking at the crucial role that psychology plays in both sports performance and also the well-being of athletes.
We'll be hearing firsthand from some of the athletes, but firstly, by now, I think we all know what a tremendous role the mind plays in any sport. And most would agree that shooting is one of the sports that rely a bit more heavily on that mental preparation. So I spoke to psychologist Pierre Beauchamp to discover his motivation behind researching and getting into the sports psychology and, well, his many findings in it. We touched on breathwork, we touched on visualization, as well as ways to prepare for a high-stakes finals.
I worked with, I was a coach first. I was an athlete and then a coach. And as a coach, I was always curious why it wasn't the best, the most talented athlete that would go the furthest in their sport. And so I went back to school after 16 years of coaching and I studied intrinsic motivation. And there I found out that as coaches, what we need to provide for our athletes is autonomy, competence, and relatedness. In other words, give the athletes choices. You can do it this way. You can use this technique. You can use this technique, as opposed to stifling their options. Second, you need to build skills. Help them to build skill sets that give them the strategies to compete at the highest level. The more skills that you can teach, the more motivated they are to come each day and perform. And lastly, you need to develop healthy family relationships with your team, if it's a team you're coaching, or an individual of in individual sports, make the pistol team, the rifle team, more like a family. And the more you create a family environment, the more the kids love coming, the more they're having fun doing what they're passionate about. All of these characteristics of intrinsic motivation help athletes to perform their best. Well, I worked in golf for 30 years. And then I get a phone call from a young lady from India, 18 years old, and said that I got a quota position for the London Olympics. Can you get me on the podium? And I thought that this was an interesting challenge. But at first I told her, I'm too busy right now. Could you call me later? And she did. She called me back. And how did she pick me? I don't know. But I came to India in 2011, before the London Olympic Games. We worked together for 6 months. She finished 12th in the Games. And then in the following year, she became the World Cup champion in the ISSF in pistol shooting. And so that was my introduction to shooting. And I applied all of the concepts that we work in golf, which is a self-paced sport. And we taught her all of the same skills. So that's how I got into shooting, and I've enjoyed it ever since. So in 2006-07, I started working in speed skating, and we were looking at athletes in a highly cardiovascular sport, like speed skating. And I knew that heart rate variability had an impact on their sport, and in sprint events, also reaction time. So having the Olympics at home, we had lots of money, and I was able to convince a technology company in biofeedback to build a self-regulation device that would measure skin conductance, skin temperature, muscle tension, respiration rate, and heart rate. And all of that together gives us an indicator of fatigue, which is heart rate variability. We also built reaction time technology and so on and so forth. And this biofeedback, heart rate variability biofeedback technology helped us teach athletes self-regulation skills. And I think we were one of the first countries to do that. And that particular team got 5 medals at the Olympics. And the other team that I worked with got a gold medal as well. So we were highly successful. And then I went internationally and taught people how to measure heart rate variability and how to use self-regulatory skills to teach athletes to compete under pressure and on demand. Yeah, so we use abdominal breathing, a diaphragmic breathing. And generally, we could say that if you were to inhale through the nose and out through the mouth on a 4-8 count, it would be beneficial. It could be on a 5-7 count, but we can measure this using biofeedback technology as one's resonance frequency. And resonance frequency is the breath that the athletes are in homeostatic balance, and so it could be anywhere from 4.5 to 7, depending on the individual. When they breathe in at resonance frequency, they can recover more quickly, and they can get in the zone more quickly. So this is helpful for many athletes who want to get into the zone in maybe 2 or 3 breaths between shots. And so breath work is incredibly important. I did work after the Olympic Games. There were a few articles, and I ended up working for a hedge fund company in San Francisco. And they asked me after my first presentation, what was the most important thing that you discovered having worked at the 2010 Olympic Games and having been successful with all these medals? And I said, it's all about the breath. And this also can impact decision-making with people working in stock trading, mainly because the timing of a decision is highly related to whether they're stressed or not stressed, and the decision that they make. So if they're in autonomic balance, what we call autonomic balance, and they're breathing properly, and they have a good thesis in terms of what they're doing, they'll usually make the right decision. And so that's been proven already with day traders in the stock market. And so this is one of the things I taught them. I ended up working with that financial company for 7 years. The frequency of your breathing is the number of times that you do it. I recommend to our Olympic athletes that they do it every morning and every evening. We have a 4-minute exercise, an 8-minute exercise, and a 12-minute exercise. The 4-minute exercise looks like this. They'll be seated, eyes open, fixed on a fixed point for pupil fixation of the eyes. And they'll sit there for 1 minute, breathing through the nostrils and out through pursed lips using diaphragmic breathing. Then they'll close their eyes in a seated position and do their breathing. And then they'll stand up because it's important to do it in standing position. Eyes fixated on a specific point on the wall, and then we'll do it with closed eyes. So that's the 4-minute exercise, 1 minute in each position. But most athletes do the 12-minute exercise after they've learned the exercise. With the biofeedback equipment, we can actually measure the efficacy of their ability to do this at their resonance frequency. So with athletes, the most common is overthinking. So we would ask them in their debrief, on each shot, are they in an optimal zone or are they in a suboptimal zone? And so we can use what we call the multi-action plan by doing a debrief on each shot. So if they're focused on their routine, their conscious routine, then they're in an optimal state. If they're in the zone, they're in an optimal state. But if they're overthinking, they're in a suboptimal state, or if their heart is racing and they can feel their heartbeat, which many of them do, then they're also in a suboptimal state. And the challenge is to teach them to be aware of what state they're in on each shot and how to get back to an optimal state. And we do this through the breath work that we do. So self-belief relates to confidence. The higher one believes in their ability and their skill set, the more confident they are. So what we want to examine there are, do they believe in their process? If they believe in their process, they're more likely to succeed. If they don't believe in their process and they go left and right and in many directions, then it's going to be hit or miss. Sometimes athletes will self-sabotage, and it's mainly because they don't believe in their process, and they believe that if I do well at the start, I will do well later. So they put preconditions on their shooting, and we try to share with them that these are irrational beliefs, and that they should be focused on one shot at a time and their process. Similarly, the irrational belief that if the first five shots go well, I will perform well. So both can get you into trouble because you put a precondition on your performance. We would rather they focus on their process one shot at a time, restart the process on each shot, as opposed to having expectations for success or expectations for failure, which gets them out of the process and takes them out of the present at the same time.
How do you address performance anxiety or these pre-competition jitters with the athletes you work with? And what would you say, what is the percentage of the athletes that are affected by this performance anxiety?
So 80% or 85% of all athletes will suffer from pre-competitive anxiety. So what we teach them is our game plans that help them mitigate what pre-competitive anxiety brings on. We would, number one, like them to embrace the challenge of competing against the best in the world, number one. Number two, what do they do the week before an event? What are their routines? What do they do the night before? What do they do the day of a competition? And then what do they do leading up to the competition? And so we talk about cycles of concentration. And in those cycles of concentration, they may use their psychological skills like, what's my goal today, my process goal, what am I trying to achieve, visualize, mentally rehearse it, do my breathing, and then maybe do some relaxation. And so as the 40 minutes before a competition starts, they have activities, behavioral activities that they're doing using their psychological skills. By the time they get to the start, this is already a template that they've used. It's individualized for each athlete. And then they arrive and they do their sighters. They don't get upset if sighters don't go exactly as planned because they know they have the skills to compete and they have a discipline routine which they follow. Yeah, so mental rehearsal is really important that they use inner feelings in their mental rehearsal. And so in the dark room, that if they do dark room exercises or holding exercises, dry fire, you want to connect with your inner feelings, what those inner feelings are when you shoot well, and what are the inner feelings when you shoot poorly. And they know what those feelings are. And when they're shooting well, they'll make decisive decisions at the right time. So for example, in rifle, if they're in the execution phase and they get the right feelings and there's good balance and stability and they're in the execution, they're connected with the target, and there are certain feelings that they get. And so they will be on time, like for somebody that has a 12 second from the last breath to trigger time, they'll be right on that time. When they have poor feelings, inner feelings, that breath, last breath to trigger time goes from 12 to 30 seconds. And so there's a lot of hesitation, there's a lot of overthinking, or what we call a decision reinvestment. And that decision reinvestment leads to poor quality shots.
Oh, okay. But what if you're in the finals and it's a single shot? 50 seconds, and yes, you have already used up 40 seconds, and you don't have time for a break.
And so this is called a critical situation. Probably, I don't think that people understand how much time that athletes spend on the mental part. We have a group of five sports psychologists that work with our team of nutritionists, physiotherapists, strength and conditioning professionals. But they're there doing the warm-up with the strength and conditioning coach. So we'll go through a physical warm-up, then we'll go through a mental warm-up. But we do this every day. And similarly, at the end of training, we'll do a physical cool down and we'll do a mental cool down. And so we do mental training on a daily basis for every training session. And that's the only way that you can integrate mental skills into your shooting so that you can then fine-tune them and individualize them so that they work for you. Without that, then athletes are trying to use mental skills in competition that they haven't practiced. And if you don't practice, then they're not a skill that you're used to calling up. They won't be there in competition. So we probably spend an hour a day doing mental training, and that's probably the minimum that a high-level athlete should be doing.
Okay. What's the most rewarding aspect of being a sports psychologist for you personally?
For me, personally, it's about enhancing awareness and seeing human beings grow. All athletes are gaining awareness. They're growing as human beings. And if you can cultivate a growth mindset where each day they're learning something new, then you're contributing to their growth. And on a daily basis, if they're enhancing their success by 1%, the continuous or cumulative effect of marginal gains of 1% can have a huge impact on their growth and development over time. And so that is probably the biggest joy that I get from working with high-level or high-performance athletes.
That was Pierre Beauchamp, the psychologist for the Indian shooting team.
Some really interesting stuff from Pierre there, Martina. And you also spoke to some members of the Indian shooting team, didn't you?
I did. I asked some of the members of the shooting team, who all, by the way, won a quota for Paris 2024 for India, how they've been implementing these mental techniques.
Mental training is just for the shooting. Basically, my technique, my work, it's like visualization of I can maybe in the hotel room or at my home, I imagine I'm on the shooting range, my arena, spectators are behind, I'm on the firing point, shooting, I see my sights and pull the trigger. Like the good things, my idol technique, the good series, I imagine them and rehearse them at home as well. So that's my mental routine and the way I prepare for the competition mentally. And before the finals, yes, I picked just one or two elements of the technique and try to focus on them. I came to this after many years. In the beginning, it was just like doing yoga and sitting for a few minutes for meditation. But as a young child, these things doesn't really mean anything to me. But later when I thought that each of the element and all things are really important to grow up, after coming to this level, it's just a margin of few points. So now I feel the importance of all the things, and meditation and mental training is one of them.
So the slight difference that we have between our qualification and the final is that the final is very quick. We don't have a lot of time to settle down. So I really try to pay a lot of attention on the preparation part of it. I try and prepare both mentally, physically, and technically before I start the positions or even before I'm there, so that I don't take too much time to settle down and I ease into it smoother. And in the final, I walk in with a lot of confidence. I feel like I own it, so that helps me. I also use breathwork, visualization, and a lot of positive self-talk. That helps.
Definitely, there's a different and very tough situation in final, but I prepare myself. I visualize, and regarding breathing, I have my personal breathing pattern that I follow, so that helps me a lot. I see myself following my short process and shooting good in attempts. Definitely just close my eyes and see myself shooting at the final hall or the qualification, depending on what match I'm going to go for.
Arjun Babuta closing things out. You can hear more from him in the 10-meter air rifle men's episode. We hope you enjoyed this look into the important role psychology plays in shooting sports.
And that's it for this special episode, a pit stop on the road to Paris 2024, which picks up again next week, as Martina and I will be back looking again at another Olympic discipline.
Yes, we are, Jamie. We'll be turning our attention to skeet mixed team event, making its debut at the Olympic Paris Games.
Yeah.
We have a great interview with three-time Olympic champion Vincent Hancock for it.
Looking forward to it, Martina. We hope you are too. And until then, thank you very much for joining us this week, and we'll see you next time.
Goodbye.